We are without our fearless leader this morning, Lisa, but we will forge ahead anyway. It looks like we are 10:05. Okay, welcome everybody. Thank you for coming and joining. We are going to move right into, I believe, our next slide is our rules and all of that, our engagement. Technology tips. Wonderful. Oh, and we are being recorded. Okay. I think we can go to the next one. I don't do that very much. Here's our agenda. I'm doing the welcome and announcements. I don't have any other announcements right now. Team, does anybody else have announcements? All right. Then I believe, without further ado, we will jump into our discussion with Dawn.
Good morning, all. It's a little, a pretty interesting time to be in the business that we're in. I want to appreciate our collaborators on the ground, the medical directors, and the CCOs for the work that you all are doing in our communities as we all head towards our 2030 goal of eliminating health inequities in a time when we are just moving into a new chapter of understanding how inequities are built into the systems that we have grown up in, and different ways that we now are challenged to not only examine how we do what we do and who we do it with and how we engage with community, but also the data that we have always relied on, that we have always considered the epitome of justice to the best of our ability to implement it in health and healthcare. Medicine, the movement towards evidence-based medicine has been the holy grail for us for some decades now, and it was a critical and important evolution for us to move to the prioritized list as a proactive and intentional way to access and review existing evidence and do the most effective job we possibly could of using it and leveraging it to its best effect to inform the services that we deliver in the form of the greatest good for the greatest number, that being more of a health, public health approach, but also an appropriate population health management approach for the Oregon Health Plan and the Health Evidence Review Committee. The HERC has done an incredible job of helping us to provide care on that basis. What we are coming to understand now and need to figure out is how the existing evidence bases do and don't serve our communities and an equitable delivery of services across the spectrum. We lack some of the tools that we need, and so the HERC staff are embarking on this journey and have been already doing quite a lot of that work. And part of it is some of the work that has come to your attention in the form of a transition for the prioritized list in the new waiver. And I want to offer whatever comfort I may for those of us who are comfortable in our grounding our clinical practice in the delivery of services in evidence and the richness of our evidence bases, and acknowledge that we have some things to learn about how our evidence base hasn't resulted in the resolution of the inequities we continue to see. And so the body of work ahead is to figure out how best to use our evidence with this in the context of this goal of eliminating health inequities. And Ariel Smith, I see you, Dr. Smith, on the line. And if you wish to jump in here, you're welcome. But the question that has come to my attention is that the CCO medical directors and others are aware that the prioritized list will be undergoing a transition in the new waiver, and whatever clarity we have to offer about that transition, we can offer it now, and an awareness that there will be dialogue in figuring out what that transition is, and that the CCO medical directors will be invited to that dialogue, which I believe is there's a plan that is being developed for what needs to happen there.
Yeah, I don't know if any of us actually know exactly what this plan's gonna but I think I've been updating you all pretty faithfully on our below the line review, and there'll be a little bit more in a little bit where we've been really looking at trying to kind of re-go over that. Don't have a whole lot more about the list and the new waiver.
Right. And I think Jason, hi. Welcome, Jason.
Yeah, Dana Harganati is coming at 11 and is going to be talking about that along with the waiver in a more broad context. And at this point, the short version is the list remains in effect as it has been. Our HERC process is not going to change immediately. There will be 20 changes in 2027, and there will be a process to determine what those are. And of course, it will center equity. I think there was some communication that went out earlier that the list was going away immediately, or at least it was understood that way, and that was not correct. And again, we'll have a more refined and focused presentation on that at 11.
Perfect. Thank you, Jason. I am delighted to hear that Dana will be able to participate then. I know that Lisa Croix, who is a primary presenter here on the agenda, will be able to speak to a lot of what's going on in that waiver. And so I'll look forward to that as well, but I wanted to address it directly that we know there is uncertainty around that. And we also recognize and believe in science and its importance in terms of determining how we deliver services. So welcome to the next step on the journey. Colleagues, thank you for taking it with us. Let's defer any additional dialogue about that to the presentation with the subject matter experts on the waiver in the 11 o'clock hour. And I'll offer a couple more updates and acknowledgements here, and then potentially move ahead. I was made
hey,
aware. Yes, Jeannie.
Sorry to interrupt. Can I just want to remind everybody on the phones, please mute. We're getting some feedback when our presenters are discussing. So please mute yourselves. And if you're trying to get off, mute, for some reason, they gave me control of this meeting, which is really exciting for me. So I may have muted you. And if I muted you, I think you can still get off mute. but it may be just, if you can't, send it through the chat and I'll figure out what I did. But otherwise, yeah, just for sakes of making sure that we can hear everybody, please keep yourself muted. Thanks. Sorry, Dawn, to interrupt.
Not at all. Thanks, Jeannie. I think star six also can help get through that second step of unmuting in those moments. I am aware that there was a rules advisory committee about birth centers last week about the licensing of the facilities, and that some topics considered controversial in different circles were discussed, such as some births that do not qualify under the HERC criteria for planned community birth. And I want to reassure this group again that that I will be in touch with the public health department group that manages that rules advisory committee and follow up on the content that I missed that day. And be aware again that just as a reorientation for those of you who may have forgotten or not been brought into clarity at the time, there are two different rules advisory committees that address planned community birth at OHA. Through the public health department, there's a rules advisory committee that addresses the licensing for the facilities of birth centers. Birth centers may offer an array of services that goes well and truly beyond the coverage that Oregon Health Plan provides. The Oregon Health Plan Rules Advisory Committee, which is managed by analyst Diane Queering, who many of you know well, manages the rules around Oregon Health Plan coverage of planned community birth. That is the array of services that qualifies as eligible per the HERC low risk birth criteria or lower risk. And so the fact that those rules advisories committees come away with different guidelines and outcomes is not fundamentally necessarily a problem, because it is Diane Queering's rack about the OHP rules that guides what OHP covers, which is the content of the services that we manage and the licensing for those facilities for people who are paying out of pocket, people who are working with commercial insurances, et cetera. That's a different jurisdiction, what those facilities are able to offer per their licensing. And there is certainly going to be a good deal of crossover, and I acknowledge that as well. And I'll stop there for the moment and field a couple of questions if there are any, or dialogue or input.
Yeah, Dawn, I think we had a conversation about this as well this morning that thank you for clarifying the two racks and the two different areas, one with the coverage and the other one with the lying in the licensing in the public health realm. I think the concern is that for members, that is confusing, and for the providers in the birthing centers may be a bit of an issue as well, where they'll be able to provide. And I gave the example of somebody who's a Medicaid member approved to deliver in a certain birthing center, goes in at 36 weeks, and our coverage goes in a birthing center 37 and above, and the 36 week person stays, delivers. And then how does that work? Or if then there's, because the CCO, that wouldn't be a covered service, but at the birthing center, that's something that they're licensed to provide. So I think those kinds of, if we're not on the same page, that could get potentially very confusing for the public, for the birthing centers and so forth. So I'm just wondering if there is some sort of crossover between those racks and how those future debacles could be avoided.
I appreciate that, Jeannie. Thank you. That the confusion, there may well be confusion about that. And so I would be happy to go offline with it with you to follow up and see what kind of solution to provide clarity to all the people involved might be appropriate. I anticipate that the delivering providers in those environments don't want to wind up in a situation where they are delivering services that are not going to be covered. And so it is very much in their best interest to communicate clearly with their patients, our members, about that. But you're right, it certainly is a confusing, it has potential for confusion and clarity we might need to do some more steps in order to make sure people get the clarity that they need.
Yeah. And I think our groups are, you know, the CCOs are definitely on board with doing and helping and being clear with the members. So,
okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
I also think there may be a role for OHA to provide some more standardized communication that CCOs can draw upon to share some of that clarity around the difference between the facility licensing rules and the OHP covered services could be part of those communications, as well as some more clarity on website and accessible materials for different populations. I'd be happy to talk with you about that, Jeannie.
Yeah, thanks so much. Sounds good.
Sure. The last question that I wanted to bring up is one that I won't be able to address because I just learned about it. But apparently there is a question about which members are prioritized for receipt of air conditioners and air purifiers. I haven't been front and center on that effort, but I can check in with that team about the list and how it was generated and some of the risk factors associated. I did review the KEPRO fee-for-service list this morning and the, you know, the high risk medical conditions that put people at risk for smoke exposure or for heat and the sort of level of utilization is available to KEPRO for some of that work. And I am delighted those are some of the factors that go into the ranking for the fee-for-service delivery of air conditioners and air purifiers. And I can only imagine that the same is true for any lists that we might be sharing with CCOs, but I don't have that information about the CCO lists today. And I will be looking into that on your behalf. But I'm happy to take any other questions about that to take along as I go looking into it.
That sounds good. Any other folks have questions for Dawn about that they would want to have discussed or? Okay, great. Thank you very much.
And that's all I have for my own updates from HSD. I would open the floor for an open forum for questions or colleagues of mine who have announcements they might want to share or questions from attendees.
Don't be shy, team. If anybody has any questions, we've got time today because I was so quick on my introduction. And we have 6 minutes before Ariel, although knowing her topics, she may be able to use that extra time. But If you have questions, don't walk away with them unanswered or at least stated. All right. Then do you feel like it's okay to go ahead and move ahead then with Ariel on and our HERC update? And Ariel, we'll give you a few more minutes.
I think that's fine, especially since the content is in the slides and anybody who was showing up right at 10:30 for her will be able to both review the slides and ask her any questions. Ariel, thank you.
Hi all, just to remind you all, my name's Ariel Smits. I am the medical director for the Health Evidence Review Commission. We've been busy this fall with lots of meetings and lots of meetings upcoming. So I'm gonna try to get through all of those pretty quickly for you. Next slide, please. And this really, really is an empty slide. This is the first time we haven't had any COVID codes and no monkeypox codes, nothing has slipped in. So maybe we're getting to the end of the COVID. Anyway, never mind, just a little celebration. Next slide. Our oral health advisory panel met last week. They reviewed placement of the 2023 CDT codes, which are the codes that dentists use. Of note, a couple of these were added for the handicapping malocclusion benefit, and the guideline for handicapping malocclusion for advanced imaging was expanded just to include the words handicapping malocclusion. And previously we had covered advanced imaging only for a repair of craniofacial anomalies. So just to clarify that was included in coverage. We chose not to include dental tomosynthesis, as this was not felt to be equipment that was widely available or used. And we also didn't cover 3D imaging of the face, but we did cover 3D imaging of the teeth because that's used in handicapping malocclusion. All of the code placements are available or should be available quite shortly on our website if you need to look at their placement. We discussed expanding indications for dental implant removals. The request had come from the Ombuds Office to expand and add additional coverage for pain. The group did not want to do this. They felt that was a very subjective type of thing and that the current guideline pretty much suffices if there's a severe issue going on that a dental implant could be removed. And there was also discussion that private dental insurance doesn't uncover any dental implant removal in general. So they felt that we were already being a little more generous. We also looked at labial phrenectomy, which is cutting of lip tie for breastfeeding difficulties. And the evidence doesn't support that this is actually helpful. And in fact, it's really difficult to determine what people feel is pathologic labial or lip tie. Not a very clear area, and it doesn't appear that that phrenectomy actually helps breastfeeding. So we elected to continue non-coverage. Next slide, please. VVBS and HERC met last week. It was a virtual meeting. We looked at the health advisory panel report and added residential therapy for anxiety. We clarified that we cover acupuncture for documented people who are in documented expanded treatment. So like you can't cover acupuncture for the indication of just alone treating SUD, but it can be covered if there's other things documented by a provider in the medical record, such as providing MAT in the primary care home. We discussed demetization disorders and elected not to expand coverage. One of the things that was done at VBBS and again at HERC was we had an in-depth review of our use of quality adjusted life years or QALYs. HERC put out a new policy or actually a couple of options for a HERC policy about the use of QALYs going forward. And I would urge you all, if any of you have strong feelings about QALYs, either for or against use, I would urge you to go to our website. This should be posted in the next couple of days as available for public comment. And we're always interested to hear what CCOs or what you as providers, if you want to do it as an individual, feel about what we should do regarding QALYs in the future, either explicitly how they might be included in discussions or whether we should exclude them entirely from any discussions. There's a couple of different options. You'll be able to see that. We're taking public comment for about 3 weeks, and then we will be bringing up the policy for final decision discussion, we believe, at the November HERC meeting. We looked at corneal collagen cross-linkage for keratoconus. This was tabled. We needed input from ophthalmology, so this will be brought up again in November. We adopted a new statement of intent for public health emergencies that mirrors the commercial policy requirements for you need to cover all treatments as defined in the Oregon statute for a public health emergency when it is declared by the Oregon Public Health Director, who is in Oregon's Public Health Division. Next slide, please. Continuing on with the October VBS, we looked at our solid organ transplant lines and kind of began a discussion about whether we would want some sort of a guideline. This is in conjunction with OHA staff reviewing our very out-of-date transplant lines, OARs. And staff has been directed back to do some more work with the transplant centers. So you'll see this in the future coming to you. We also talked about hydrocele repair for adults. Again, this was tabled to get some expert input, and we'll come back in November. As part of the below-the-line review that I spoke of just briefly earlier, we have been, HERC staff has been reviewing lines that are below the funding line for conditions that should be considered for reprioritization. We looked at several orthopedic lines for congenital anomalies of limbs and knees, and basically did housekeeping items. There were some codes that were on covered and uncovered lines. They were removed from an uncovered line just to clarify, so there wasn't a question about when they're covered and when they're not. Nothing was changed on the congenital anomaly, the knee line, which only contains a few diagnoses. We looked at genitourinary conditions with no treatment required, and we again did a couple housekeeping changes. We moved a couple of gynecologic conditions that need diagnostic testing to determine the underlying cause to the diagnostic list. For congenital ear anomalies, we moved microodia, which is congenital lack of a complete ear. We already have anodia, which is lack of an ear on a covered line. We're moving microodia to a covered line with a new guideline that allows treatment if it would improve hearing loss, if it would allow the use of a air-based hearing aid, or if it would allow the use of things like eyeglasses. And there is a new guideline that will go in along with that to help clarify for you when microodia is covered. We didn't get to CPAP titration, that was tabled, and we'll be bringing that back in November. Is along with that topic for November, we're going to hopefully be discussing how you define a hypopneic event. I know that's been a real issue to several of you, and hopefully we will get some sleep medicine specialists to help us clarify what criteria should be followed for defining a hypopneic event. So look forward to that in November. We discussed chronic disease self-management programs, which are CDC recommended programs for management of a variety of health conditions. This was actually referred to our evidence-based guidelines subcommittee to do a multi-sector intervention. So you'll be seeing that again in the future. This does not include diabetes prevention programs or fall prevention programs, which we've already determined that we want to cover. Next slide. And then the HERC, as you can see there, we talked about QALYs. We also refined the scope a bit for our continuous glucose monitoring coverage guidance, which is going through the HBS process. Next slide, please. We have another BHAP meeting tomorrow. It's a virtual meeting. You're all welcome to attend. It's from 9 to 11. We are going to be talking about the 2023 behavioral health related CPT codes. One of these is for multifamily group behavior management therapy for mental or physical health diagnoses. And I'm going to get their feedback on which mental or physical health diagnoses could most benefit from this. There's also a new remote therapeutic monitoring for cognitive behavioral therapy. We currently don't cover any remote therapeutic monitoring, and that's the recommendation, but we'll see what BHAP, what input they give us on that. The perpetrators of abuse diagnosis code was actually taken care of last week at VBBS. These are the diagnosis codes for, we currently cover treatment for a perpetrator of child abuse. These are for additional types of abuse, perpetrators of spousal abuse or other abuse. And this, we are still working behind the scenes with HSD staff and others at OHA to work out when this treatment would be something that would be in the corrections sort of. If it is court ordered by a judge, it would be in corrections or on the perpetrator. If it's deemed to be medically necessary, then it would fall into the health plan's management sphere, but we're still working on a little bit of that behind the scenes. Another thing that we're talking about at BHAP is intentional self-harm codes. Currently, these are all not covered. They're all on informational diagnoses. Includes suicide attempts, which is actually on the diagnostic list, as well as intentional self-harm with 100 different ways of harming yourself, like ICD-10 codes do. We're going to ask them if these actually should be covered for some type of psychotherapy, as well as just covered for the treatment of whatever event or whatever harm had been done to the self. We are also going to be briefly touching back on things like schizotypal or malingering, those types of personality disorders. They had discussed that at one of their last meetings and not wanted to cover it. HERC staff has found quite a few instances where various things were covered for people, so we just want some input on if there is any time that we should be covering any of these. So again, this is tomorrow at BHAP, and you're welcome to come. Jeannie, I see your hand up.
Yes, apologies. I just, you said something that kind of made me think about an issue that I think is currently a problem, which is where we have, what you basically said was the talking about the whether or not if it's, if the judge says it has to happen, then it stays in the judicial realm. Whereas if we determine it's medically necessary, then that goes into the CCO realm.
We're still working rules out on that.
Yeah, I would just encourage, because this in the court, the option of treatment versus going to in the judicial system, the option of treatment versus going into jail for members, where you can go into an intensive treatment program and have this monitoring, that being then covered by CCOs versus what's on the plan for the member if they're within the judicial system, has created a problem for the providers doing this care, because they're caught in the middle without being compensated for the work they're providing, because the CCOs are like, this is not medically necessary, and the judge says, well, it's out of my hands. And so it's leaving a whole group of people caught in the middle, and the people who suffer the most are the member and also the provider who wants to do the right thing and provide the treatment. So I would say if there's any way to clarify that in these discussions coming up, that may actually be helpful in other realms where we are seeing this as a big gap and problem.
Yeah, and we had actually talked about conduct disorder at a previous meeting. And that's kind of another place where you might see some things, mostly with the youth authority. So yes, we have meetings on the books with other staff to try to hammer this out, and we might need to have DOJ get involved as well to give us some advice.
Sounds good, thanks. Let me know if you need any concrete examples. I have a few.
Actually, I would love some if you have any, because BHAP is tomorrow morning, and if you have any specific things that they might need to give us some guidance on, I would really appreciate that.
What time are you meeting tomorrow?
Apologies. 9 a.m.
Okay.
It's a virtual meeting, so.
Great, thanks. If you can send me that, I'd appreciate it.
The invite?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry for the personal.
No worries.
Okay, go ahead.
Sorry, just making a note to myself. Okay. Next, any other questions about BHAP or BVBS or OHAP? Sorry, I'm kind of going through a little quickly. Next slide. Our genetics advisory panel is also meeting on Wednesday. In Wednesday afternoon, again, a virtual meeting, you're all invited. We're doing our typical updating of our NCCN references that we do every year just to bring our guidelines up to date. There's a couple of CPT codes related to genetics. There's some just some of their basic lab codes for some reason have been revised and published, which will be interesting. I think those will just be things that we want to continue to cover. A new cytochrome P450 code, we have these covered with a guideline, so that'll just be added to the guideline. And then there's inherited bone marrow failure syndrome testing, which also was recommended for diagnostic. And then there is TPMP gene and enzyme activity testing. So this is, I'm sure it just trips off your tongue, thiopurine S-methyltransferase testing. This is a enzyme that's involved in processing a couple of pretty toxic drugs that are used to treat acute lymphocytic leukemia, particularly in children, and can also be used for inflammatory bowel disease. Currently, we don't cover the gene testing. The new code is actually for the enzyme testing. So this is a case where there is a gene that controls how much of this enzyme you have. But then there's also, which would be your genotype, there's also phenotype testing. So even if you have a genetic problem, some people have normal levels of enzyme or vice versa. These can make a really large difference in the toxicity of a few of these drugs and would lead to management changes. If you were known to have an issue with this enzyme, they would choose different treatments. And this is particularly important for ALL treatment in children because these are pretty toxic drugs. So the recommendation is to add coverage for both. I have heard from at least one of you that you only cover one or the other. So that will be something that we discuss at GAP, if we only cover one of the two, which is the more important, or if we should only cover one if the other's already been done, or how we're going to do this. We're also looking at some next generation sequencing, targeted genomic sequencing. There's some panels that are new codes. These would be tests for a solid tumor. They take a sample of the tumor and they run a large series of genes to find out which mutations cause the cancer, and that helps you target your drug therapy. I've worked with several of you as well as several other folks in our genetics world to come up with kind of a broad guideline that basically says that you should cover these gene panels in certain circumstances, particularly if they'll change management, if they're brought up with NCCN as one of their sort of treatment branch points in their algorithms, et cetera. So we will get GAP's input on that, and there may be some tweaking of that guideline language. And this would just be for panels, and HRC staff are also kind of looking at the individual biomarkers tests, and we're going to get some input from GAP on whether we should have a similar just kind of broad guideline about individual biomarkers or whether we should actually go back through the whole EGBS process and update our biomarkers guideline. Jeff, I see your hand up.
Oh, thanks, Ariel. I think you actually just answered my question after I put my hand up.
No worries.
I have grave concerns about these large genomic testing panels. And I've never been at one of your meetings. Are they open to the public?
Oh, so yeah. Yep, they're absolutely open.
Do you get comments from or representation from the companies that do this testing?
I don't know if any have signed up.
Okay. They can be very aggressive.
But yeah, if you would like to come, I believe it is 1 to 3 on Wednesday. Let me...
I will try my best. Yeah.
Yes, it's 2 to 4 on Wednesday. Okay. And they're open to the public. And the advisory panel meetings for all of our advisory panels are a little more casual. So we typically are, you know, people who are there can chime in and jump in. You don't have to sign up to be a formal testifier. You just have to come to the meeting.
Okay, thank you. Because, you know, I mean, this is one of those things where certain testing is very beneficial, makes a huge difference in how we oncologists treat patients. But like so many technologies, it's like mushroomed so that, you know, you have to pay, they want you to pay for 324 tests, of which maybe 8 have clinical significance, you know, and then they cost $8,000 to $20,000 instead of $2,000, and so I'll get off my soapbox. It's just it's a world where things can be a mess. So
yeah, and we need to do we need to do something with these new panel codes because we have to put them somewhere. And
of course.
So, and one of the options would be to use the guideline that we drafted as sort of what I've been kind of calling a holding guideline, to just kind of have something in place until we can get a more formal analysis done. But again, we'll kind of see what the GAP members have to say. And then, yeah, there's the whole topic of individual biomarkers and how they relate to these panels. And it gets very down the rabbit hole very quickly.
Yeah, thank you for taking my question.
No worries. Anyone else have any questions about GAP? Okay, next slide. So our next VBBS meeting is coming up just before Thanksgiving in November. Again, virtual meeting, you're all invited. So far on the agenda, we are looking at our usual consent agenda, including re-reviewing kyphoplasty. It was requested by an industry representative. It hasn't been reviewed in 5 years, so we redid a review, and there's still not evidence that it's particularly helpful in the long term. So the recommendation at this point is to continue non-coverage. We'll be talking about all of our advisory panel reports that you heard the topics of already. The 2023 CPT and HCPCS codes placement. I don't have HCPCS codes yet, so if any of you get those, please let me know. But we do have the CPT codes. A lot of them, it was a smaller than usual set. A lot are straightforward. We are going to be talking about a few things. One thing, if any of you have anyone who is a good surgeon with wound repair, there's a new code for absorbable mesh for delayed wound closure, which currently I think is a bad idea. It sounds like it's just sort of a increased risk of further infection. But it does seem to be something that's pretty commonly used. So I'd love if anyone could send someone my way to talk about that. Other things are, there's a new RSV vaccine code, which is weird because there's no new RSV vaccine. So if anyone knows of anything about a new RSV vaccine, CDC doesn't have anything. And then a few other things that are pretty straightforwardly experimental and we're not going to cover. We're going to be looking at botulinum toxin for strabismus. And the recommendation so far is to keep our very limited coverage, as the evidence shows that surgery is a lot more effective than botulinum toxin. We are looking at some new indications for acupuncture. The only one that really seems to have strong evidence to support it, moderate level of evidence is myofascial pain, fibromyalgia, which is an uncovered indication, but we're going to recommend adding acupuncture to that uncovered line. There's the sleep study issues that I previously discussed. Next slide. And there, of course, will be continuing new topics as they come up. And we're always happy to take new topics from you all. EBGS will be meeting again in January. They're going to continue their bariatric surgery procedures review, as well as the continuous glucose monitoring report. And then coming up is, as I mentioned before, the biomarkers next generation sequencing review. Next slide. And then always looking for more topics. So feel free to send anything our way. Next slide. And sorry for the screaming redness. I know you've been seeing this for months and months, but this has changed now for the HERC.info. And we have heard that all of the staff emails will be changing in January. So just keep an eye out for that. Until then, these are all the ways to reach staff. And obviously the HERC.info is functional and we are happy to get input that way. Any just questions for me or issues that the HERC needs to consider?
Once again, we have Ariel. This is our chance. Don't let it go. Don't walk away saying, "I wish I would have said something." It benefits us all. Those questions that you think might not be helpful for everybody could be. So don't hesitate. All right, Ariel. It looks like you're getting off easy.
All right, folks. You know how to get in touch.
All right. I think, Jennifer, what do we have next on our agenda? I think maybe we don't start until 11.
That's correct. Yeah, there's a break until 11.
Okay. Oh, good. Everybody gets a quick break. I think there's always a reminder of not to put us on hold, right? Otherwise, we hear everybody's music. Or did that end at some point in time?
That is right. I'll put that slide up that shows what to do.
Okay, excellent. Right, everybody's got 10 minutes then. We'll break and we'll see y'all back here at 11. Thank you. Dawn, anything before we break?
I was going to say thank you to you. Nice facilitating, Doc.
All right. Talk to everybody soon. All right, everybody, welcome back. It's spot on 11. And I think we will go ahead and get started with the next part of our programming. We have Lisa here to talk to us about our Medicaid waiver summary and relay all this good news. I will just let you know, I was actually able to listen to a call. I think it was 2 days after it had been announced, and my boss was unable to make the meeting. And she said, "Jeannie, can you jump in and go to this meeting?" Well, little did I know this was a meeting with CMS about the waiver, and listening to CMS and the leaders on the federal level talk about our waiver and what Oregon is doing and what Massachusetts is doing, and kind of the uniqueness of our waiver and what we are doing. I was so proud to be an Oregonian and so proud to be part of this process. It was incredibly exciting. So I just want to say, you know, thank you, first of all, to everybody who's been involved in this waiver process. I think it's been incredibly, probably difficult and yet rewarding for everyone involved. But just thank you. I'm super excited to be involved in this work going forward. And thanks to all of you for the work you've done. So Lisa, you're up. Take it away.
Well, thank you. Thank you for such a nice introduction. My name is Lisa Kreis. I'm the Waiver Renewal Project Director. And I will just say that it has been a huge effort with a lot of people moving this work forward. So it's been a pretty extensive team, lots of work streams to get this over the line. So I just want to echo the appreciation of all the staff and partners that have participated in making all of this, getting this approved. It's definitely been a big project. So I just want to confirm that someone is going to move through the slides for me. I don't think I can actually do that from my end.
Yes, this is Jennifer Bowen. I'll do that for you.
Thank you. So we can go ahead and go to the next slide. I am going to turn off my video while I go through these. My screen just isn't big enough for me to see. I don't need to see myself, but I can look at the slides a little better if I do that. All right. So today what we want to cover, this is a pretty long slide deck. Can you remind me how much time do I have? I want to make sure that I have enough time for questions at the end.
Yeah, Lisa, I think you have 2 minutes, so go ahead and get started. No, I'm just all kidding. Right. Just kidding. Jennifer, how much time does Lisa have?
Well, she has an hour, but then there's a to be determined at 12. So there's another half hour that I don't know if it's been accounted for, but
yeah,
at least an hour.
Yeah. So Lisa, I hope you brought a bottle of water there at home with you or whatever you need.
That's great. I've been trying to do questions and answers in this presentation in 30 minutes and it's challenging. An hour is completely fine. Awesome. So that's great. And so we'll just make sure we address questions at the end.
Okay. So would you like everybody then to hold their questions until the other end, to the end, or how do you feel about people putting their questions in the chat and then addressing those at the end? What's your preference?
Yeah, putting them in the chat, I think, is great. I think it may be difficult to get through if we try to address questions as we're going through, but I'm happy to circle back on anything.
Okay.
I just want to make sure that we give an overview and then we can circle back and try to get to everyone's questions.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
All right. So what we're going to cover today are the authorities that were included in this waiver, this five-year waiver from 2022 to 2027, the waiver funding, and then the next steps and opportunities. Next slide. And the next slide. Thank you. So just a reminder, I think you all have probably seen this slide quite a few times as we've been going through this waiver process, but our overall goals for this waiver were to advance health equity. To achieve this, the policy framework was broken down into drivers of health inequities and actionable sub-goals. So that included ensuring people could maintain their health coverage, improving health outcomes by addressing health-related social needs, ensuring smart, flexible spending for health-related social needs and health equity, and creating a more equitable, culturally and linguistically responsive healthcare system. Next slide. Thank you. So the first authority that we're going to cover is continuous enrollment for increased access to care and to improve health outcomes. Let's see here. Oregon will provide continuous enrollment for children through age 6, regardless of when they first enroll in the Oregon Health Plan and regardless of changes in circumstances that would otherwise cause a loss of eligibility. OHP can provide 2 years of continuous enrollment for people age 6 and up, even if their eligibility status changes. So this is really, you know, it's incredibly groundbreaking authority that we received. We're one of the first states to receive this. I will also note that this goes into place after the public health emergency continuous enrollment coverage ends. So it will not start until then. Let's go to the next slide. So health-related social needs benefits for individuals and families experiencing critical life transitions. This term, health-related social needs, I will just say from the beginning, it probably sounds very familiar to health-related services. This is the term that CMS wanted to use. We had previously really talked about this as the social determinants of health benefits. So that's the new term and where it came from. Oregon will provide health-related social needs benefits, housing and nutrition services to people who are going through life transitions. These health-related social needs services will be Medicaid benefits. So the people who are eligible for these services. Sorry. I needed to let my puppy join the presentation or he's gonna continue to bark. So these benefits are eligible, or people who are eligible for these benefits are people who are experiencing homelessness or at risk of homelessness, youth with special healthcare needs now up to age 26, youth who are child welfare involved, older adults who have both Medicaid and Medicare health insurance, adults and youth leaving justice involvement, and adults leaving the state hospital. Next slide, please. So Oregon will also provide health-related social needs benefits to related to extreme weather events. These devices include air conditioners, air filters, generators to people with a high-risk clinical need who reside in Oregon that are experiencing extreme weather events that place the health and safety of the residents in jeopardy. This would need to be declared by the federal government or the governor of Oregon for us to be able to provide these benefits. Next slide. So there are three different bundles of benefits. And those are housing, food, and climate. Housing supports may include one or more of the following components: rental assistance or temporary housing, home modifications like ramps, handrails, environmental remediation, pre-tenancy and tenancy support. So this is housing applications, moving supports, eviction prevention, housing focused navigation, and our case manager. So in the food bundle, it may include one or more of the following components. Links to community-based food resources, nutrition and cooking education, fruit and vegetable prescriptions for up to 6 months, and healthy food boxes and meals, medically tailored meal delivery. And the third bundle, the climate bundle, may include, I think I mentioned this previously, devices to maintain healthy temperatures and clean air, including air conditioners, heaters, air filters, and generators to operate devices when power outages occur. So next slide, please. All right, so I've mentioned some of these previously, but I do want to pull out some of the comprehensive investments in children's health to advance health equity that are included in these authorities. So as I mentioned, Oregon is now able to provide continuous enrollment for young children until they reach age 6. OHP will include all early periodic screening, diagnosis, and treatment required services for children and youth up to age 21. Youth with special health care needs or eligibility criteria will allow the youth to have expanded benefits, including EPSDT, through age 26. So that is an expansion. Health-related social needs benefits will be available for youth with special health care needs, children and youth who are welfare involved, and youth involved in the criminal justice as well as their families. So next slide. So also included in this waiver process, Oregon and CM were changes related to the prioritized list. Oregon and CMS agreed that the prioritized list as it is currently used in Oregon's Medicaid program no longer requires waiver authority, and that's preferable to transition the prioritized list to the state plan. Given the nearly 30-year history of the prioritized list, the state will need to complete a detailed regulatory and operational review with the potential for meaningful changes in laws, rules, or processes. Accordingly, the waiver of amount, scope, and duration will terminate January 1 of 2027 to give the state sufficient time to make these necessary changes. Next slide. So new federal funding through the Designated State Health Program, which I'm going to refer to as DSHB. So that's a total of $1.1 billion over this five-year waiver period. Oregon received the authority for $268 million DSHB federal buyout for the 5 years of the demonstration. The buyout allows the federal matching funds for a state-funded DSHB program that frees up state funding to support youth with special health care needs coverage and the health-related social needs services and related infrastructure investments. The freed up state funding will result in $1.2 billion across the demonstration, which includes a state contribution of $88 million during the last year of the demo. Therefore, the federal funds are $1.1 billion for the demonstration over the 5 years. So we'll get into a little more detail of the funding, I think, in the next section. Next slide. I think that was just an overview. Yeah, sorry. I think actually we should move that slide should be in this next section. Go ahead and go to the next slide, please. Yeah, so here's just, this is an example. This is a DSHB example. These are not real dollars or real numbers. This just explains kind of how DSHB works. So you see in column A, original program is funded by 100% state funds. Column B, it shows the claim match on current state-only funded programs. The original program remains the same funding, same level of funds. The new federal match results in state fund savings. And so then you see in column C, we're able to invest state fund savings into the targeted investments with federal match. So if we go to the next slide, we can see a better overview of what it looks like in our demonstration. Yeah. So here's just an overview. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this. This is really just to kind of show how DSHB is spread out through the waiver for the 5 years, the state contribution, and then the areas that we're covering, the health-related social needs, youth with special healthcare needs services and infrastructure. So that's just an overview of the five-year period. Let me see. Yeah, I can answer any questions about this, but let's go ahead and go on to the next slide. So there are legislative concepts that were put forward related to our waiver. The first one is related to implementing DSHB and what we need in order to get a statute change for those payments related to DSHB. The next legislative concept that was put forward is the CCO Quality Incentive Program. I'm going to go to the next slide, which describes that a little bit more. So here's the legislative concept detail related to the Quality Incentive Program. Oregon is looking to shift efforts upstream. Oregon wants to ensure quality and access through equity-driven performance metrics by revising the metrics program to focus on traditional quality and access for downstream health and creating a new set of equity-driven performance metrics for upstream health factors. This is to make significant progress in driving the system toward more equitable health outcomes. So Oregon plans to work to change the quality incentive program in a few ways, to split its current metrics program into two parts, upstream and downstream. We call them upstream and downstream because it's like a river, focusing on things that cause poor health. We can catch and address them before they show up downstream as worse health outcomes. The change in the committee structure would be to shift to include more that are most affected by health inequities to lead the CCO Quality Incentive Program, more seats for OHP members, community members from diverse communities, individuals with lived experience of health inequities, and health equity professionals and researchers. Next slide. So the next steps and opportunities. Next slide, please. So there is quite a bit of post-approval work with CMS that we've tried to capture here in the next, it's really actually 30 to 150 days. We have a maintenance of effort requirement around housing services and nutritional supports. We have the health-related social needs implementation protocols on services and on infrastructure. We have the health-related social needs implementation plan, and we have the waiver evaluation plan, all due within 150 days. Next slide. So there were a few things that we were not able to complete negotiations with by the end of September. And so CMS has agreed to continue those negotiations. These are the different negotiation topics that we'll still be working on. That is the community investment collaboratives, the tribal related request, the pre-release coverage for justice involved populations, the pre-release coverage for state hospital patients. Some of these may include additional DSHB funding with our negotiations. So that's to remain to be seen. So next slide. So what was not included in this waiver? Rate setting flexibilities that were in the four CCOs, which were in the initial application. Pharmacy flexibilities, Medicaid enrollment via SNAP, employment and transportation, health-related social needs benefits, and covering peer-delivered behavioral health services outside of a care plan. And that is now moving to a SPA. So next slide. So here are some of the October engagements that we've scheduled to date to go over the waiver authorities. I will say this is kind of outdated every hour because there are more and more engagements that we're scheduling. But please reach out if there are groups or committees that we should be connecting with. That we may not have listed here. Again, this is not fully comprehensive because it's really changing hour by hour. Next slide, please. Here is a really high level implementation timeline. You'll see EPSDT is really the first and only in January 1, 2023. The implementation planning for health-related social needs will happen in 2023. It says actually, oh, implementation. I think there's a typo on 2024. It will, health-related social needs, benefits and services will not be rolled out until 2024 with a full year of planning ahead of that. Contracting is listed in 2024. Continuous enrollment, there's an asterisk there. Again, that will only begin after the Families First Act sunsets. 2025, a new five-year contract for CCOs, 2027, the prioritized list. So next slide, please. Okay, that's it. I see there's one, I think there's a question in the chat, but happy to answer questions either in the chat or if people want to raise hands.
Hey, Lisa, this is Jeannie. That was my question in the chat. It was just a question around the three bundles and whether or not the defined populations were the same for each bundle or if the defined populations change for each bundle.
Yeah, that's a really good question. So for the housing and nutrition, the housing and nutrition bundles, those are the same. There is a clinical need requirement for the climate bundle. So that one does have different requirements. Any other questions?
Thank you for that. Everybody's got it down, huh?
And the members who are eligible are listed on that previous slide. I can run through that list though. Let me see here. And those are people who are experiencing homelessness or a risk of homelessness, youth with special health care needs now up to age 26, youth who are child welfare involved, older adults who have both Medicaid and Medicare health insurance, adults and youth leaving justice involvement, and adults leaving the state hospital.
Thank you. Deanne, it looks like you have a question. Go ahead.
Yes, good morning. You know, in looking at the lists of who's eligible and criteria, it's feeling a little nebulous still. And I know it'll take time to work things out, but I think that it would be helpful to have those conversations sooner rather than later, because obviously there's sort of a whole lot of space between nobody gets housing support and every OHP member in the state of Oregon gets 6 months of free rent paid, you know? And so it's what are we anchoring to and how do we really get to that sense? Because I think the messaging is gonna be important. We don't want members and we don't want community partners maybe misinterpreting the scope of it and those types of things. And so I think that's gonna be a critical element of the rollout. And I certainly would appreciate understanding a little bit more about how we're going to arrive at very concrete criteria.
Yeah, that's a great question. And right now we're in the process of transitioning and standing up the implementation operational team for these authorities. So that is all being planned, kind of have parallel tracks because we actually will continue on with negotiations as well as those other items that I listed that need to be done in the next 30 to 150 days. But we can certainly bring that back as we get that structure for implementation and operational more kind of firmly designed and bring that back and let people know. I know that there's also a CCO health-related social needs, I think it's called a work group that's been happening and is happening to kind of start those conversations. I believe that began in July. So that's another area where those conversations are happening. But again, we're gonna have another team that's really doing more concrete implementation and operational planning and outreach.
Lisa, can you clarify what work group you are referencing?
Yeah, I wanna get the title right. I can put it in the chat. It's the CCO health related social needs, a work group, I believe it's what it's called. And I believe they provide updates at the CCO Ops Collaborative. There was a request at a couple meetings kind of early this summer to get participants from the CCOs. And I believe there's at least two participants from each CCO on that work group.
Great. And then Maggie, I see your hand up.
Oh, thanks, Jeannie, and thanks, Lisa. Very exciting. So these particular social services become HRSN benefits. What happens, if anything, to our current health-related services? Do those just dissolve for, so if you're a member not in any of those categories, do you not have any access to health related services, or what happens with that dynamic?
Yeah, there isn't a change to health related services as they exist right now. There won't be a change. These health related social needs benefits are Medicaid benefits. They will be Medicaid benefits in 2024. And they are only, you do have to be in an eligibility category to be able to receive them. So the health-related services as they exist right now, which are different, and I really just wish that we did not have this kind of language issue that we're having with this name. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of confusion around this, but this is really the term that CMS wanted to land on. So these are benefits. They are only eligible for those populations that are described. Health-related social needs will still function in the same way.
So that's really helpful. So basically we're wrong, or at least I'm wrong when I tell people, oh, HRS is now HRSN, because that's not true. It's a whole different thing.
No, but it's a really good call out that we need to really put together some materials with really describing and the differences and defining these so that people are clear. So thank you for that. We will do that.
Okay, Lisa, I just wanted to clarify, so you'll take that back. Okay, wonderful. Yep. Thank you. Thank you, Maggie, for that clarification. And hey, hi, Laura. I see you. You're up. Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you, Lisa. It's been a long time.
It has been a long time. Nice to see you too.
I have a quick question. So under the second bullet where it talks about the EPS DT, it doesn't really call out the handicapping malocclusion change. Are we just assuming that is and bundled in with this bullet?
I'm not sure I know what that is. Jason's coming, who can help me? Jason.
I can speak to that. So handicapping malocclusion will be a covered benefit, irregardless of EPSDT.
Okay.
It'll be on the prioritized list, and there is a guideline for that. With EPSDT, if someone is denied handicapping malocclusion by a plan, there will be appeal rights pursuant to the EPSDT.
Okay. Thanks, Jason. I appreciate the clarification.
Yeah, this is Jeannie. I think the other part of that clarification is if that was a medical or a dental benefit, correct? Wasn't there, is that lie within the medical part?
So there are some services. Orthodontia is a oral health benefit. There are some cases where oral surgery is needed. From OHA's perspective, my understanding is we'll contract with the coordinated care organizations and they'll need to coordinate that care because we won't have DCOs anymore.
Okay. Thank you. I know there's a lot of work around that. Oh, go ahead. Apologies for interrupting. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, this is Dana Whiffle-Lama. To follow up on Laura's question and clarify, the handicapping malocclusion is being added to the line on the prioritized list under craniofacial anomalies as one of the criteria that would allow ortho to be covered, because currently ortho is not covered except for a medical diagnosis of cleft palate, cleft lip.
Correct. It is being added to that same line, and that there will be a new guideline note that'll appear.
Right. So then EPSDT is not specific to a line as much as it is a eligibility for all the services, regardless of where the line is.
Right.
Based on medical studies. Okay.
I'll give a very short version of EPSDT, and maybe somebody from HSD can back me up if I get something wrong. But, for services that are denied because they're below the funding line, after January 1, there will need to be an individual review of medical necessity and an opportunity for there to be an exception made based on the individual circumstances of the child, if that service is deemed medically necessary by the plan. It would be any service, in the dental context, it could be anything that's in the unfunded region, or in the medical context, anything that's denied because of it's below the line of the prioritized list will need to have an appeal right and an individual determination. So the only reason you deny something can't just be because it's below the line. There has to be an individual determination.
Thank you, Jason, for that clarification. I think we'll probably have ongoing discussions at maybe one of our next QHOCs as well about the EPSDT and just continuing to see how that's being implemented. Make sure we're all on the same page. Any other questions about the waiver and kind of, I'm trying to move this so I can see. Okay, let's see here. Yeah, I'm getting a couple of questions too about this the work group. I think that's a little confusing for a lot of us because we don't know which two members of our teammates of our CCO may be on that. Is there a way to clarify where can I find that and make sure I get the link out to everybody here, Lisa?
I don't know if it's on a webpage, but I can certainly follow up with that list of CCO members. I can get that to you if you could get that, if you could share that with everyone.
Absolutely.
And I'm sorry, I'm not sure if it's the way I joined, but I don't see any questions in the chat. So if there are questions, I'm just not seeing them.
No, you're good. You're good. Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, I think you're seeing everything that's in there to discuss. So yeah, perfect. All right. Any other topics or discussions on the waiver? Very much appreciate your time, Lisa. That's very helpful and exciting.
Great, thank you. And I'll follow up with that information. And you know, please reach out if there are any other questions related to the renewal.
Okay, wonderful. And you would be our best contact to do that, to reach out, Lisa. Okay.
Yep.
Excellent. We'll make sure and put your email and name and number everywhere. You might see it in the OHA bathroom. I'm not sure, but we'll try to be good with that.
There's also a waiver email address, which is at the end of the slide deck as well.
Oh, okay. I'm not sure if people do you. There it is. Okay.
Excellent. So we monitor that and respond to everything that's coming in and have been doing that. So also a good option.
Excellent. All right. Thanks. All right. Jennifer, you were on it. Okay, Lisa, thanks so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right. I think we are at the end of our packed agenda right now because we had another half an hour for a kind of roundtable discussion. Jennifer, is that correct?
Yes, I think so.
All right, then I think we should take this time for just a minute here to see if there's some issues or roundtable discussion that people want to bring up, maybe for our upcoming QHOCs or just topics that you've been burning a hole in your mind to have a conversation about. That was a terrible reference. Apologies, but anything that's really top of mind that you want to talk about. No more burning. That's terrible. Need more coffee. You guys are a quiet group, man. If I was stand-up comedy, I would be in trouble. Lots of trouble here. Oh, Cynthia, go ahead. Excellent. Yep.
Yeah, I haven't attended this meeting in a while. It's usually a major conflict with me, but I'd like to think about that, Jeannie, and bring some back. I just wasn't prepared this morning. I'm sure when I'm not in this meeting, I can think of a dozen. So,
yes, please, no worries. You can send them to me or Lisa or Dawn, any questions, and we'll get them. We have an agenda planning meeting that comes up a couple weeks before the meeting, and we try to bring in new ideas or what people want to hear. So please do feel free to reach out.
I do know that in doing our QAPI, you know, and then looking and assessing the year prior, I've asked forever. And if this is true, if something already has been developed and I don't know, I apologize, but having a consistent, not a template, but things that should be included in a QAPI and a year before assessment, I think would be very helpful. Am I making sense? It just seems like everybody's doing their own thing and we all want to get it right. So that would be helpful from my perspective.
Yeah, sure. I will send that in an email for sure too. And I think we have other QAPI minded folks on the call. Any other comments on that? All right. I will just make sure and bring that up with Lisa. Thank you, Cynthia. All right, team. Well, I'm not a fan of keeping a meeting going if everybody's done. So Jennifer or Dawn, any closing comments or discussion?
Nothing for me.
Excellent, team. Then you're going to get about an hour back. I know. Dana was supposed to be here at 11:30. Oh, does somebody want to ping Dana to see Dawn? Can we ping Dana to see if she's going? Oh, I hear Dana. I see Dana. Hi, Dana.
Hi, good morning. I've been here. Actually, I was just present for Lisa Coy's update on the waiver in case I was needed and just to listen in to the discussion. So nothing additional for me. Please proceed with ending early.
Okay, excellent. Now that we know Dana's here, or I do, I wasn't looking. Were there any questions out of our co-med group from previous that you'd like to ask her? I think the only one was really about the prioritized list that Dawn brought up a little bit earlier. And then I think Ariel commented on Dana was the prioritized list in 2027 and the work to be done, over the next coming years and really making sure that that is part of our process and as seen as an Oregon administering benefit, you know, the benefits in Oregon, and that's part of the process. And I think the question is, or the idea that has come up in the previous discussions was, that's amazing. We love the idea of and the intent to get our prioritized list because we all depend on it and find it incredibly valuable into the system in a way such that it's codified or put into the system in such a way legislatively, however that works. However, there was a little bit of reticence or kind of thoughts about that, the process to actually get that done. So the intent is fantastic. The process can be pretty difficult. And so I think that maybe folks would just like to hear a little bit about maybe what that process is or when it would start and how do we get this going and done soon to make sure it truly happens.
Thank you, Jennifer. I can definitely share some comments, and I apologize. I was not in the conversation earlier today, so I'm stepping in without the context of the commentary or questions that came up earlier, but happy to step in. And I had the opportunity also to speak with the Health Evidence Review Commission on Friday as well, so can really expand upon that or share some similar comments that I think meet what you were just describing. So I guess extending from what Lisa Coy was just sharing in more brief terms, as you all know, the prioritized list and the role of the HERG remain in effect right now. What is changing is the authority, which allows us to continue the way we do our work. And that authority, moving from our waiver to a state plan amendment, will occur by January 1st, 2027. And as I shared with the HERC, the important and foundational role of the HERC is not changing even beyond. We will continue to rely on the Health Evidence Review Commission to guide decisions on efficacy and medical necessity criteria in the transparent and public and independent process that exists. And we're grateful for the work, and that is important as an Oregon way moving forward as we move into a SPA. There is obviously, this has been in a waiver authority for 30 years, and we need to take time to make sure as we are working with CMS and others in this move that we're sure we have everything lined up through statute, through the SPA, through any rules. And we're currently starting to do that analysis, but know that it may take time. We're not sure all that it will involve, and that's why we requested that this requirement of authority change not occur immediately, but give us the time to do that. I guess, you know, the details of exactly how that looks are still to come. Again, we're starting with that deep dive review, between now and 2027, we're gonna continue to work really closely with CMS, legislators, OHA staff across our agency, you all, the HERC, members of the public, and affected communities to inform any decisions that are needed as this transition occurs. And while we're doing that, we're also committed to our goal of equity. And part of that includes ensuring that our processes through the HERC and otherwise, you know, are accessible to the public, and so that the HRPS process is continue to be informed both by the available evidence as well as extensive input. We've done a lot of changes over 30 years to ensure that is the case, and we will continue to explore opportunities to expand on that as we take that review in the next several years. So I don't know that I have a lot of details on exact timelines and how. Maybe that was the question you started with, but the commitment is there, and kind of the baseline by which we're moving into that analysis is what I was just trying to describe. So I hope that is helpful, and I can take additional questions.
Yeah, I'll just say while I'm looking for hands to come up. Yeah, I think Jennifer, we can take down that last slide now, and then that'll make it easier for me to see everybody. Yes, I think that is helpful, Dana, and I appreciate that. I think though I am curious about the process, I don't know much about a state plan amendment. So I'm just wondering, is that led by the OHA then? And that's your teams, and you will have a team, and you will have a project, and there'll be these things that you go through, and then will we get kind of progress reports on how you're doing, or where does that ownership and that process lie? I just don't know.
Yeah, and thanks for the question. It's a good one. And as we get a little further beyond kind of this original announcement about the waiver, I think we can share more detailed updates for you. The state plan amendment process is one that it will be led by our Medicaid team in submitting that proposal. Obviously, teams across our agency will be involved, including the HRC team, as we just mentioned. So it will be a cross-agency effort that will be one that will be engaging multiple partners, as I described. So it will be in coordination with CMS to make sure we understand what they're looking for or what their requirements are in with regards to the state plan amendment. It will be any changes to meet those requirements that might have to take place. It will be engagement publicly and with partners to do that. So ultimately, the submission of the state plan amendment is done by OHA and led by our Medicaid team, but it will be a very coordinated process, and hence why, you know, the 3+ years to get there is why we really wanted that long timeline, in case it's needed.
Excellent. Thank you. So just to clarify, what I heard was Medicaid team leads it, but OHA leadership is responsible for it happening, right? I mean, that's kind of how that leads. So the Medicaid team's responsible for the whole process, the cross government and the coordinating and the community, but the ultimate responsible party is in the OHA.
Yeah, and when I mean Medicaid team, it's our Medicaid team within OHA, sorry for lack of clarity. So it is OHA's responsibility, and it includes team members from across our agency to submit the state plan approval or for approval. And Jason, if you wanted to add in here, I just want to make sure I'm not saying anything just as I'm looking at your face to make sure.
That's correct. It will be the Medicaid team submits the state plan amendments as they are. Often do when there are changes to the Medicaid program. This will just be, you know, a broader effort because the HRC is not technically in the health system division. So, and obviously it's a big change to our program that'll impact a lot of places. So we want to coordinate with all of our internal and external partners to do it well.
Yeah, this is wonderful. I mean, I think that's great. And thank you for the explanation. Like I said, I haven't followed how that process works, so I appreciate that. And then I think we could say, you know, as the CCO medical directors, at least here on the call, that we definitely would love to, however we can, obviously be part of that process. Sounds like it'll be across departments, and happy to help. And also, if we could, request that, like you said, once you guys get through this whole thing, you can digest it, kind of get your processes, that maybe we plan for some sort of regular updates on how it's going, because I think it causes us a ton of anxiety. And the way I like to make sure that we're staying in contact and not having that anxiety is to maybe just put on the calendar some regular feedback events where we know that, you know, quarterly we're going to hear about how this plan is going, or every other month, or however that works out with your teams. But would love to just request that on our that makes my communication as the go-between here a lot easier, and that would be super helpful.
Yeah, thanks for that, and totally acknowledge and understand why this is so important to this group. I absolutely think that's reasonable. I think those updates may be just a little slower as we're grouping in this initial period, and obviously can pick up with regularity as we get a little further into this work, but we'll be glad to keep that communication and coordination wide open.
Excellent, thank you. Well, part of being a good teammate is allowing your other teammates grace. So we absolutely have that time where we're supportive, and sounds great. Okay, team, I've dominated the conversation. Apologies. Any other questions? We don't often have full access to Dana here. I don't want to put you on the spot, Dana. Any other questions about this topic? Okay, I'm scanning the crowd and it looks pretty quiet out there. I think everybody's good to go. Wonderful. Well, thank you. Remember to have your post-meeting release, your mindfulness. Also just remind you to exercise your mind and mindfulness and positive thinking every day, like you might your physical body. It's important. Something easy to do is two thoughts of what you have gratitude for every day. Just really quickly, two quick thoughts will get you in a nice positive mindset. Today, I woke up and I was super happy for my kids and grateful for my kids because they play in sports, and it allows me, I get to go to events like Friday Night Lights to watch soccer games. And it provides a lot of joy for me. And I was also incredibly happy for Como toast this morning. I don't know if you guys eat Como, but I absolutely love it toasted with a lot of butter. And I was incredibly happy and gratuitous for that this morning. So anyway, easy things, but remind to keep you positive and enjoy the rest of your day.
Everyone, welcome to this afternoon session for QHOC. Lisa Bowie is not with us today, so I will be going ahead and as your afternoon chair facilitating today's call. I do want to go over some housekeeping tips. Just please remain on mute unless you are speaking, and then you may unmute your phone. There is a mute unmute icon on the bottom left hand side of your Zoom screen. If you happen to be double muted on the phone, you may need to dial *6 to unmute if double muted. We do have a few people still joining us, so I'm going to kind of slow down a little bit to make sure everybody gets in before our presentation starts. During the presentation, if you would like to ask a question, go ahead and raise your hand. The raise hand function is in your Zoom under reactions. You will be recognized prior to speaking and participate in any votes that may be occurring, which I don't think we have any votes today. State your name prior to speaking. Turn on your camera when you're speaking. This ensures that all listeners can follow the conversation. Today, we are going to have a presentation done by the DOJ MFUCU and OHA and OPI regarding roles, responsibilities, and referrals. Is Fritz Jenkins or any of the presenters on already?
Hello, this is Caleb Richards with Office of Program Integrity.
Hi, Caleb. If there are no questions from the floor or anything, we can go ahead and start your presentation. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you. So hi, everyone. My name is Caleb Richards. I'm a research analyst and manager of our investigations, research, and policy units at the Office of Program Integrity. And with me presenting
No. Can you dial in on your phone by chance and see if that helps?
Is this better?
Yeah.
There it is.
Awesome. Thank you.
I'm going to use Zoom since I have a new audio system. So I had to change some of the settings real quick. Sorry about that, everyone. But I'm Tamara McNatt, and I co-manage the Office of Program Integrity with Caleb.
And Jennifer, with us today, Jennifer, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, thank you. I was just going to ask Jennifer to continue.
Do you want to go ahead and begin the presentation for us?
Yeah. And also with us from the Office of Program Integrity, they're in the chat. And if you have questions at some point, they'll help us. There's Willie Verrett, Allison Tonge, and I think Bambi Hines should be on as well today, but she might be audio only. So with that, Tamara, I'll let you take it away with our presentation.
Sorry, Caleb, I'm having some audio difficulties. I couldn't quite hear you.
That's right. I was just saying, feel free to start on the next slide for us then.
Perfect. Sorry, everybody. I think I'm all good to go. So I'm going to just take a few moments and just kind of reintroduce you to the Office of Program Integrity for those that may not be as familiar with our structure and kind of what Program Integrity kind of is from a very high level. So the Office of Program Integrity sits within the Fiscal and Operations Division of OHA. And as you can see, there's kind of three main components that make up the office. There's the SIRS SIU. It was too long to put in there, but it stands for Surveillance and Utilization Review Subsystem. Then there's PIAU, or the Program Integrity Audit Unit. And there's also the policy work that we do. So next slide, please. This slide breaks down the two primary teams that make up our Office of Program Integrity. There's the team that I manage, which is the Program Integrity Audit Unit. As you can see, we're comprised of many government auditors that perform the audit work, as well as a medical review coordinator. We won't be going too much about what my team does, as the focus of this presentation is on fraud, waste, and abuse investigations and referrals, but wanted to give you kind of an overview of how that team's made up. And then Caleb's team, he's the manager and research analyst, and I always have to refer to my notes for this, to the Surveillance and Utilization Review Subsystem team. That includes the data analysts and researchers. It includes someone who manages our demand audits that are distinct from our medical review audits. We also have a certified public accountant that looks at financial investigations and audits for us as well. And then this is also where the fraud, waste, and abuse work lives through our certified fraud examiner, who's Bambi. Next slide, please. And I think many of us on this call are going to be familiar with our Medicaid service delivery system. The intent of this slide is really to highlight that program integrity really works across both service delivery systems, the managed care entities or CCO system, as well as within the fee-for-service. So we perform a lot of the work we perform is across both service delivery systems. Next slide. And then you can go to the next slide as well. So what is program integrity? From a 40,000 foot view, program integrity is really here to ensure the appropriate use of federal and tax dollars, to ensure that we're delivering covered and appropriate services to our eligible individuals, and to ensure that we're not diverting any funds due to fraud, waste, and abuse. And within this work, program integrity really tries to strive to meet many outcomes. So if we go to the next slide, I won't review each and every one of these, but this slide really is to highlight many of the actions that we wanna take associated with the program outcomes that we strive to achieve. For instance, compliance with not only state federal rules and guidelines, but also federal rules, guidelines, and mandates. We want to lessen or reduce risk of beneficiary harm. We want to improve not only beneficiary satisfaction with the system and with their covered services, but also provider satisfaction within the services they provide as well. And just ensure that there's better outcomes and improvement of quality of care across the system. So next slide, please. And Kind of in short, both Program Integrity and CMS, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, we want to ensure that there are safeguards in place across our policy and programs that provide those safeguards for payment integrity. And it's kind of at the core of the work that we do. And the next slide, if you want to go to it, really highlights that our work within Program Integrity spans across all of the Medicaid program, as you can see here. And if you go to the next slide, which is going to look very similar to this, the focus of this presentation that we have for you today is really on the fraud, waste, and abuse investigation and referral work that we do in collaboration with MUFUKU. So with that, I will turn it over to Caleb, who will go a little bit more in depth into the OPI portion of the fraud, waste, and abuse work. Thank you.
Thanks, Tamara. Yeah, so today we're going to be focusing on the investigations aspect of our work and how that relates to the referrals that we get. So if you had looked back at the slide where you saw all of the individuals in my unit, you would have seen Bambi Hines as our certified fraud examiner. And when our coordinated care entities send us in fraud referrals, she's the one that handles all of those, tracks them, and keeps track of any investigations and actually performs most of the investigations herself. So it's specifically about that work that we'll be talking about today. So next slide, please. So when Program Integrity receives our referrals, they often present in a number of different ways. A lot of the issues we deal with don't necessarily mean that intentional deception has occurred. The problem that can be referred to us is often in the realm of honest mistakes, such as billing or inefficiencies in billing systems and bending of the rules sometimes, that sort of thing. At the Office of Program Integrity, we investigate all of these mistakes and inefficiencies so that we can find the root cause of them and correct for future billings. So every once in a while, there is intentional deception that happens. And that results in the fraud at the far right end of the spectrum, as you can see, where very serious cases are handled jointly with us. And then Bambi will often also refer those on to our Medicaid fraud unit so that we can discuss those cases together. But as we move left on the spectrum, we can see mistakes can result in just common coding errors, or there could be waste in overutilizing specific diagnostic services, or there could be abuse in the types of coding that is performed in medical claims. So with that, let's move on to the next slide. And I'll talk specifically about the fraud aspect of our work. And I'm only going to highlight this a little bit because I know the second half of the presentation handled by Medicaid fraud will actually be addressing specific cases that they've seen. So fraud occurs when someone intentionally executes or attempts to execute a scheme to obtain money or property of any healthcare benefit program. This would be the intentional deception part of the fraud, waste, and abuse I talked about just a moment ago. And we look at these cases very seriously. But another part of our work occurs when issues of waste and abuse enter the referral realm, and when providers act in such a way that unnecessary costs are spent. We investigate these referrals specifically when we are looking at creating audits for Tamara's unit and Program Integrity. We'll do a medical review to make sure that any overpayments that are assessed by our auditors are demanded back from the provider at the end of an audit. So that kind of encapsulates all three facets of the fraud, waste, and abuse work. If you could go to the next slide, please. And this slide serves to remind us that fraud, waste, and abuse affects all of us in the Medicaid world, specifically when dealing with these referrals. It's not just an issue for the Oregon Health Authority, but draining these critical resources that are limited and should be going to Medicaid recipients is at the forefront of what we deal with. And no one really likes tax dollars being wasted. So we take all of these cases and give them the amount of dedication and seriousness that they demand. But fraud, waste, and abuse instances often lead to multiple parties being involved. And many of you can recall meetings you've had with Bambi recently. I know we've been on a number of calls where a provider can be dipping into many different funds or have business relationships with lots of organizations, including the Oregon Health Authority. And those have been great discussions that Bambi has facilitated, where we get to talk openly about the waste or abuse that we're all seeing and collaborate together. So next slide, please. So specifically when we receive fraud, waste, and abuse referrals, our certified fraud audit examiner, Bambi, investigates every single referral that comes in, and she has a long process that she does to vet each one to make sure that initially she can locate the provider in our Oregon Medicaid database. And then she also will validate any claims data that is sent our way so that we can either say definitively we can that the data can support specific allegations made in the referral, or sometimes the data just doesn't support very specific allegations, not necessarily because the referral was false, but usually it's that the data is not robust enough to show us the nuances that might be happening in these billings. So after she's done her initial investigation, OPI, or the Office of Program Integrity, decides on an action, and that will either be to audit, to refer to someone else, a more appropriate agency, or sometimes we make other notifications to the CCOs about potential exposure. But as far as the referrals go for her side of things, so far this year, she's had over 400 referrals just since January. I know in calendar year 2021, we saw over 370 referrals. 373 is my last check on this. And an initial estimate that I gathered was approximately 24 of them resulted in audits by our Program Integrity Audit Unit. We're trying to keep track of how many referrals we're sending out as well. And I've seen about 4 out of 12 we made last year that we specifically marked were sent to Medicaid fraud were accepted, and some action was taken over there as well. So we're seeing really good numbers here. As a data and research analyst, I know that maybe sometimes this gets a little into the weeds, but I just like that we can very clearly support here that those referrals coming into us are resulting in some very meaningful results and actions. So keeping this in mind, I want to move on to the next slide though, and say, whenever we get referrals in, data is one of the most important things that we look at. So data is kind of my theme for the day. The more data that we have, the faster we can analyze these referrals, the better actions we can take, and the more information we can pass on to other agencies if it's determined that the specific investigation isn't most relevant to the Office of Program Integrity or the work that we do. So more informative referrals can lead to, like I said, quicker investigations. It'll lead to more time for more complex cases. As I said earlier, we've had a couple of roundtable discussions with many of the CCOs or individuals doing investigations on your behalf, where we discuss all the nuances that we get over on our side, and we can share what have you heard on your side about this investigation. And swapping all that information really helps lead us to better decisions that we can't make when we're just working in our own world. So, and then finally, the most important thing for us is always getting better outcomes for our Oregon Medicaid members, since that's the forefront of the purpose of the work that we do. We're always keeping that in mind and making sure that the Oregon Medicaid recipients are receiving the benefits of the work that we do, and that all of the money is being used appropriately. So with that, I think I'm going to move on to a couple of examples around referrals. One specifically on how we can improve some of the referrals that we get, and that's that first slide here, thank you very much, of some common referrals that we get every once in a while that are really hard to take action on because of the lack of data or information that's given to us at the beginning. So this referral right here was sent our way, and I've made up some of the numbers and taken away any specific names so as to not call anyone out. But the allegation here was just stated, as you can see on the screen, provider may be overutilizing E&M codes. Usually that is not enough for us to take some significant action on. There can be up to 10 different E&M codes at the beginning of the investigation that I can think of with CPT or sometimes HCPCS codes that we're looking at. And just getting a general maybe overutilizing codes isn't enough information for us to make a well-educated first step on when Bambi is starting out her investigation. So if you'll go to the next slide, I've written out some notes on how to improve specific referrals like this. And there are 10 steps that we'll go through. First off, something that's very useful for us is knowing the specific Medicaid IDs that we receive about this referral. We can see that a client or provider name was provided here, but when we go into our database, sometimes providers have similar names, or the LLC or billing agency for that provider sometimes goes by a different name, and they're hard to find. So, but if you have a very specific Medicaid ID or a TIN number, tax identification number, or any identifying number that we can put into our database, that's a really great first step for us so that we can make sure that we have the right provider when we're doing our investigation. Second of all, if it's for a whole clinic, sometimes specific provider names are important. So in this case, I've just made up Medical Clinic LLC was referred to us, and we don't know if this referral is about the entire clinic overall, or if it's about specific individuals at that clinic. So the description should include the provider name so that we know exactly which doctors or medical professionals are being referred to us for us to investigate. So point three, I already mentioned a little bit, would be the specific codes that are involved in the referral. In this case, it's E&M codes, so everyday office visits, encounter and or maintenance codes that the provider will type in. In this case, it's overutilizing codes. So if I had a specific 5-digit code, I could go into our database and find the Medicaid provider. I could look up how many of the one type of code they're using and compare them to other providers in a similar peer group or profession to see exactly, okay, how bad is this problem? Are they billing just egregiously too many of these codes, or is it more nuanced than that? Point four is specific dates of service that are at risk. So in this referral, I don't know what year even would be referred to us. Sometimes referrals come in very late just because of the amount of time it takes. If a individual makes the referral, it could go from them to a healthcare provider to some web portal and eventually end up at us quite a ways down that list. There is a way to refer specifically to us, but that means by the time I'm reading the referral or by the time Bambi is dealing with it, we don't know what year the claims may have originated in. So specific dates help us decide when we can start analyzing the trends that we see. So point five is who the original reporter of the fraud referral was from. So this could be, like I said, sometimes from a Medicaid recipient, but every once in a while, we'll get referrals from fraud partners around the state or around the nation about fraud trends to look out for. And if it's that type of case, we know that we need to keep our investigations more general and look for different types of trends, not specifically about singular named providers. So the original reporter is also often important to know. You'll notice that there are a couple of none fields that were just left blank on this referral form. So part six, the allegation received date. So in other words, when your investigator is making referrals to our office, it's important for us to know when you received the allegation so that we can know about how much time has elapsed. I know it's important for some of the work that Allison does with policy on deliverables, but it's also good to know how much time has passed so that we know how much action has been taken. If it has just come into your office a day or two ago, there probably hasn't been much time to do a lot of the in-depth research about billing trends. But if it's been there for a while, we might ask, okay, what action has been taken so far? What are the specific trends that you're seeing in your data? So point seven, another thing we couldn't see in this referral is specifically which coordinated care agency or organization had exposure here. So financial exposure can be broad ranging. This provider could be billing many different organizations, including Medicaid or private insurance. And it's really important for us to know that when a referral comes into us, we can expect to see Medicaid dollars at risk here. If not, then that will tell us which appropriate agency to refer it on to. If there aren't fee-for-service Medicaid dollars at risk, then Bambi refers out to the appropriate agency. So point number eight is a very important one, and that's, is there suspected fraud? So I talked earlier about intentional deception. If someone is just flat out lying that they saw a recipient, and that recipient is saying, I've never seen this doctor before, or there are many, many different ways someone can intentionally commit fraud. And that is sort of a flag that Medicaid fraud can look at and say that referral should specifically be managed by them when it comes into our agencies. So that is really important for us to see. Point nine would be if you have time, if say you've had this for a couple of days, you've looked and seen that yes, there is some estimated financial risk with this referral. When we refer back out to other agencies, we always include this to say, here's how much money we see we have at risk with this code. If I can see for a month of time for a specific provider, how much have they been paid by the Oregon Health Authority or Medicaid to perform these services? And then also based on the encounter data, we can say, we expect that you might have this much money involved in the referral. That way it's just a good double check between us that we're both on the same page and that we all know how much money is involved with the specific allegation. And then the final point I have for this would be that how many other individuals or agencies have been alerted. As I said, sometimes providers can have their hands in multiple different pots. So a lot of the time we need to coordinate all together, and knowing who is already involved in an investigation is a great way for us to know who needs to be alerted otherwise. And I see our first question. Cynthia, do you have your hand up?
I do. Hi, Caleb. It's Hi. Nice. Oh, hold on. Let me get my camera on. Sorry. Can you all see me? All
yes, right. We can.
Frightening, I know. Just bear with me. You know, sometimes we make more than one referral from our CCO, All Care. Mm-hmm. And when we get down, let's see, you don't have the submit button, but when we submit, we don't know, has it been received? It would really be helpful to have a circle, like a loop, just sending an email to our email saying your referral was received. It always feels right. Weird. Laura, please feel free to chime in. We just don't, we don't know if it's gone into a,
and, right.
And Bambi does get back to us, but I'm talking about that initial sending in that referral, because you know that there are time frames associated with these referrals, right?
Right, exactly.
Mm-hmm. So it also helps when submitting additional information once we've done that initial submission, if we had like a case number or something that we can associate additional information for, so that it says that, hey, for case number 12345, here's additional documentation of our investigation or what our final outcome was or things like that. That way we can correspond our investigation with what we submitted to you guys.
Exactly.
That's a great point, Laura. Thank you. Anyway.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Both of those are great points. And I think hopefully my next few slides address those issues for you. I know specifically the webpage that this screenshot was taken from when the initial referral is made. Unfortunately, we don't have control over that site. So we can try to put in a request for it to auto notify you back, but I'm not sure how that process goes on the technical side for it to be sent back to you. But my solution then is forthcoming, so that we can get those communications going more consistently between us. So hopefully, if I haven't answered your question by the end, let me know. But I think in two slides you'll see our plan to address that issue.
Okay. And Caleb, I have another question in the chat. Do you want that now, or would you like to wait till the end of your presentation?
Let's take that question now.
Okay. And the question is, what about referrals relating to FWA behavior by members, where the member is the perpetrator?
So, right. Member issues should go to our fraud investigations unit. If we ever see an issue like that that's referred to us, we do refer it on, but we don't deal so much with member fraud. Ours is provider fraud, waste, and abuse.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So moving on to the next slide. This is another example where the referrer did include all of those 10 points that I listed out previously. Again, I've made up numbers here and names. But this was an email that was sent directly to Bambi and Shannon. And if you email them directly, that's a better way for Bambi to get back to you and Shannon as well, I would assume, so that they can say, here's the action that we're going to take. And once we've decided on a specific action, if there's any back and forth that's needed, this is the easiest way for us to deal with that. So here we can see, and again, I think Jennifer, you're managing the slide clicks. I have some check marks that pop up on the screen. So if you'll click through, I think the first one notes that the specific provider name here, I just bolded the word provider, but there was a name and a brief description of the allegation that is being reported, specific services, and included OTPT code being billed. The next point I have are three, actually, so you can click forward three times, I think. You can see the NPI was included, the TIN, and the Medicaid ID. So in case one of them fails, we have three different ways to find this provider. The next point is the provider name and clinic, specifically with a date. It's saying, here's the per organ Medicaid provider, the file dated this date with the NPI, so we can see specifically what dates of service are at risk. And if it's not a whole clinic, the individual that is being referred to us. Next point would be the location. Sometimes if it's a clinic, there are multiple locations across the state that I've mentioned. So that helps us identify more or narrow in more specifically on a provider. The next point is the type of clinic being referred to us, so we know specifically what policies to look for, how many services are average for that peer group, and that helps us decide whether or not this individual is an outlier or not. The next check mark I have states where in your side of the investigation you're currently at. So this is just saying we just received this investigation. Essentially, we're in the initial stages and we have not been able to substantiate the allegation yet. So that helps us know that we're both kind of on the same page. We're both starting this investigation together. And then finally, my last two double check here at the end tells us which CCOs are involved. And I know sometimes this list can get long, but it helps us identify, you know, where the highest risk is. So a lot of the time this will just be one number, but sometimes it can be two numbers. Sometimes it can be just a rough estimate as of, you know, for these dates of service, the provider was paid this much. We assume that OHA and the fee for service side will have roughly this much money involved. But this really hits all of the major points so that we know what the best first step is. So, and like I said, this actually came in on an email directly to Bambi and Shannon, which is going to be our preferred method going forward, since that previous slide showed, I think, a database where it gets referred out to many agencies. Bambi does go through that, and she will continue to go through that database, but it's a lot of work weeding through lots and lots of different referrals. Can be hundreds on there, and I think she gets alerted as to specific ones that should be coming to us, but something I forgot to point out was the specific area of that referral defaulted to food stamps. So even though that was not at all related to the allegation, I think the system just automatically defaulted, like, food stamps is the first option. So that's not relevant information to us. And it takes Bambi a longer time to scroll through and find those ones then that are very specifically related to the Oregon Health Authority's program integrity aspect. So, and to make this process a little easier, because you can see all the bullet points here make it look like a very long list that's difficult to keep track of, what we've done at program integrity is actually create a form. And this is where I hope I answer your question, Cynthia. So if we'll move on to the next slide. We've created this form to help keep track of the most important aspects of the referral submission process. So when we get this form, we can know specifically when it was detected and when it was referred to us so that we know to respond back in a timely fashion with the investigation that we're performing then. I've made all of these fields fillable, and I think it was provided today to everyone. And we're also working to include this form on our Oregon Health Authority website so that it will be downloadable in the future. It's not available today, but if you don't have this form yet, please let us know and we'll do our best. Also, if you have Bambi's contact information, she can get that form to you as well. But this is what we're hoping will be the best tool for all of us to stay on the same page in the future. You can see provider name, provider IDs are included. The allegation summary leaves space for you to hopefully include any other information that doesn't neatly fit into one of these fields for like a number or a contact name. That's where you can include that we got this referral from this individual and they're saying that this service wasn't rendered or that they're worried that they're being billed incorrectly, that sort of thing. And you can really go into more detail there. Secondly, how you became aware of the potential fraud, waste, and abuse helps us be able to keep a log, like what Cynthia was talking about, of where this referral has gone. And then we've also left a third option for additional notes. Then the bottom of it, the bottom of this form is very specific data elements. So status of the investigation, you'll also see a radio button for suspected fraud. If you click yes on that field, then that is going to be sort of an alert to Shannon and those at the Medicaid Fraud Control Unit to say that they think this should be specifically referred to Medicaid fraud and that they should take the lead on that. Helps us know which agency should kind of lead up the investigation. We still want this form to go to both individuals, as that's what has been required so far. So we can keep the same process that we've had, where Bambi is the main addressee on the email, and I think Shannon as the secondary CC'd. But that will be an indicator of, you know, was fraud actually committed, or is this most likely a billing error? The other thing I wanted to point out is there are a couple hyperlinks. So those blue underline areas on this form, those will link out to web pages at, I think the top one is a CMS web page that just gives some guidelines of how they see the referral process going and key elements that they think are necessary. Those are just guidelines and suggestions that we're including right now in case you ever lose this presentation today or forget one specific thing that I was saying today of, oh, what was that 10th point that Caleb included on that slide? Well, some common suggestions are included in that link for you. And then what constitutes fraud is the second link that will go out to the DOJ page for now, outlining specific instances of what to look for in fraud. And then the bottom fields are to help us start our data analysis, the date range, initial financial exposure, and other agencies that have received the report already. So does that help, Cynthia?
Yes.
Wonderful.
The element that I'm very glad is there is the suspected fraud. Because sometimes when we make this referral, and if you look at the contract, we don't have a choice. We have to refer.
Right.
And so often it ends up, there were claims miscoded, but it was not in their favor.
Right.
So I am really glad to see that button. Great. That is fantastic.
Wonderful. I'm glad to hear that. And we're talking about possibly putting a little asterisk here that very clearly states clicking yes here will make Medicaid fraud take a second or a closer look at this. Like I said, it's still going to be going to both individuals because that's what's, as you said, required right now. But that's going to sort of be a visual cue to Shannon of, oh, I should pay extra attention for what the specific fraud element is in this referral. So yeah, I'm glad to hear that this is a welcomed form that will hopefully make all of our work a little easier and help facilitate some better communications. So.
Well, Bambi's been great, but you know.
Oh, I love her. Yeah.
we always want to put it through here so we get credit for it.
Right.
So, yeah.
Right. Yeah. And that's going to help us keep track of how many referrals. Like I said, at the beginning, I could see 373 for last year, but it's really hard to search back if we have many databases for trying to pull all these together. So hopefully this will be better data tracking for us as well. So
thank you, Caitlin.
Thank you very much, Cynthia. All right, and then we can move on to my last slide here before we hand it over to Mufuku. But just as a wrap up, hopefully this helps facilitate some communications between all of us. It's going to lead to more effective actions that hopefully lead to better outcomes for our Medicaid recipients. And, you know, we're all in this together in finding fraud, waste, and abuse. So if there is any feedback or questions at this time, I'd love to open it up for a couple minutes before I pass it off to Mufuku.
Hi, Caleb. This is Laura Matola. The only one question I had was if we can get Shannon's email. We have Bambi's, but I don't think we have Shannon.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I think so. Sheen and Shannon, I'm not sure if Shannon will be speaking, but I'll let them send that. I don't have her email memorized. But yeah, that should be available if someone wants to put that into the chat. Who?
Hi, Caleb. Shane. I can do that, or there's a link to the flyer, and the flyer has on the back page the email address for Mufuku.
Right. Wonderful. Yeah, I think that was included to everyone as a handout today. I forwarded that on. So, are you seeing that, Laura?
Yeah, it, I'm not seeing the link, but the handout was given to us on Friday. Lisa got it out to everybody on the QHOC distribution list. So if anybody who does not have it, let us know and we can get it to you. But wonderful. I'm seeing the hyperlinks on the form for the allegation summary and the suspected fraud. Those work, but I'm not seeing any other links on here.
So not on the form, but I think there was a flyer sent out from Sheen's office separate from the form we were just looking at. Maybe that one wasn't included yet. I'll see about getting that one back out to Jennifer.
Yeah, Caleb, it was circulated Friday. And it's the second page of that Medicaid fraud unit flyer.
Okay. Sheen, do you have the name of that flyer just in case people are searching through their files right now looking for that
one? I think it's called Flyer.
Okay. I think it might be part of one of the packets. It looks like maybe page 16 of 21.
You know what? I can put it in the chat for everyone anyways, but
okay.
In a few seconds. Okay.
Great.
Perfect. Thank you. Yeah.
Good question. Yeah, because that'll be important to have Bambi's and Shannon's email so that it's going to both places and you're getting credit for that.
Yeah.
So, oh, here's flyer. So.
And Nick has a question or his hand raised.
Hi, Nick.
Hi. Thanks for the time. I just did have a question if this at all changes or affects our quarterly reporting that we do, the spreadsheets that our contract deliverable. Is there any, I'm assuming these should be in concert, but I just wanted to see if there's any changes on that end based on this form.
Right, good question. So hopefully this will make just those deliverables and contract requirements easier to keep track of. There aren't any actual contractual changes right now. That's not what we're talking about. It's just an easier way to make the referrals that are already happening. So same process, whatever you've had going on, it's going to be the same continuing, just hopefully making your job a little bit easier.
Sure. And then I may have missed this, but will something be sent out to the group? Because again, I'm not as close to this as some of the folks in our SIU to kind of maybe help them or educate them on this process. And maybe that's just what you're talking about.
Yeah, so hopefully, I don't know if you've seen the material sent out yet, but the presentation that I gave and the referral form were sent out as specific items, and we welcome you to send that on to whoever you need to from our side.
Yeah, I probably have it. I may just not haven't seen it yet, so thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
And I don't see any questions in chat or any more hands raised. So if you guys want to continue, that'd be great.
Perfect. Well, then I'll pass it over to Sheen with Medicaid fraud. And thank you all for letting us speak today.
Hi, everybody. So Laura, before I begin, I just wanted to ask you a quick question. I think I put it in the meeting chat. I feel like I'm being high maintenance, but I'm wondering if it's possible that we don't record the session that we're going to do. And the reason is because we have some case materials in here. And sometimes, you know, years later or whatever, a case might be expunged. And it makes it very difficult for us to deal with cases that should no longer be circulated. So is it possible to turn off the recording?
That would be an OHA question. So Jennifer, since you're the one recording.
Yeah, I can pause it.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, it'll just a second. Okay.
I think the only thing we have left on our agenda for this afternoon session is just open items from the floor. Does anyone have any open items or any topics you want to discuss? Any topics you want for future QHOC meetings? Now's the time to speak up. And again, it is very quiet. Well, if nobody has anything further, we will go ahead and end the session this afternoon. We'll give you about 17 minutes back into your day, and we will see you next month. Thank you, everyone.